Hello, friends. Last time we left off as England was saved thanks to William the Conqueror from the brink of destruction by corruption, despotism, and black magic. Now, as William laid below in his grave, the task was left to his genius scholar of a son, William II. William was naturally loved by the English people, praised for his piety, and much like Edward the Confessor, refused to have children, as they would only distract him from his great duty of protecting the nation. Sadly, this meant that it was William who must now be the first to deal with every Englishman's worst enemy. While William was adopted lovingly by his countrymen, the people saw the pettiness in his brother Robert's eyes, and so naturally the French began to manipulate the fool. Over the coming days, Robert plotted with the priest Odo, who himself was jealous of his betters, once leading a failed invasion of Italy to claim himself as the Pope. Not knowing the irony, Robert believed Odo when he was told that he should rebel against his brother for the crown, using his lands in Normandy to launch his attack. When William heard of this treachery, he simply sighed and summoned his loyal men to prepare for war. Like so many of his ancestors before him, he now also had to deal with their greedy siblings. As Robert arrived in England, he was utterly hated by everybody but the nobility. Even the peasants, if you would believe it. Because of everyone hating this silly billy half-French boy, Robert was forced to stay in his useless little Norman lands across the channel for now. There, Robert went into a frenzy, blocking every wall there was, preparing for an attack, just like Harold did with the first William all that time ago. Days turned into months, however, and Robert began to only become more paranoid of what his brother was planning for him. William, however, had absolutely no intention of invading Robert. Instead, he used mind games on him. He promised the nobles they could have more gold to hoard and the soldiers great reforms and laws. This infuriated Robert, and finally sent Odo out to go on the offensive. Odo began his attack through the capture of a castle in Sussex, only for the next day to see the entire castle surrounded by loyalists, alongside the rightful king, William the Younger, himself attending as well. The siege lasted 6 weeks, and Odo was about to give up when Robert caught wind of these events, and sent soldiers to rescue Odo's forces. Luckily, Robert was hasty in his soldiers being sent over, and storms sunk their ships and left Odo stranded, and soon after captured, seeing no other way out. The rebellion finally ended as Robert was dragged to the feet of William, begging for forgiveness, and promising to never again betray him. Which surprisingly, William agreed, leaving Robert all of his land in Normandy, but making him renounce his claim and forcing him to stay in England for the remainder of his rule. Odo, on the other hand, was punished with the full force of William, stripped of all his land and wealth, and then punished Normandy to never again spread his filth and lies to England again. William then sat back, prepared for a peaceful reign, when a priest came from the Vatican with urgent news.
With Thor's power destroyed, new demonic forces were spread across the world, and the most dominant right now was from the sands of Arabia. This land that...
Jesus Christ.
This land, the Christians were slaughtered by the thousands, tortured, maimed, and eaten just for the taste. It was then that the glory, goodness of godliness, Pope Urban II declared a crusade against the evil that was plaguing the Holy Land, and that England should help save these ancient lands.
Sensing a chance to flee from his righteous punishment, Odo volunteered to travel off and assist this crusade, alongside Robert, who begged his brother for the chance to redeem himself, to which William accepted. In order to raise funds, Robert sold William Normandy for 10,000 marks, a reasonable exchange for the time.
I mean, I was a businessman doing business.
He prepared for his travel to the Holy Land. As Robert was gone, he had to deal with Malcolm III of the Scots attempting to invade from the north, only to be repelled by superior Anglo swordsmen, and then making Malcolm pay tribute to William in his country's national goods of gold, bagpipes, and haggis. William, at that point, remembered that barbarians don't know what toilet paper is, let alone what a peace treaty is. So it was no surprise when the armored ginger beards rode down again, only to cross a beaten road, be ambushed, and killed. William made sure his top man, Robert de Mowbray, had Malcolm and his son Edward both killed during the fight.
My ancestors are smiling at me, Imperials, and you say the same.
You Imperial bastards!
Justice!
This time, when peace came around with Malcolm's brother Donald, he agreed once again and rode off home. But as Donald sat in his hut in Scotland, he saw as Malcolm's son Duncan was riding over towards him with an English army. At first, Donald tried to argue that they had a deal, only for the English to remind him that they did the same, and now it's payback time. Donald ran away as Duncan was placed as the new king of Scotland, now civilized, just like an Englishman, and trusted William and England with all of his heart, giving an oath of loyalty to the man he knew.
Dylan!
You son of a bitch!
Once again, however, in William's great wisdom in mind, he forgot something. The Scots were uncivilized savages, and therefore saw any new ideas as incompatible with their tribe's so-called traditions. So it wasn't long before the monster Donald struck back with the rest of his thieving countrymen joining in, unable to understand the great chance to grow as a people in society. And of course, whenever barbarians dare to attack the English, there is one force you can expect to be at the bottom of it. That's right, the Vikings were somehow still alive like the frozen fish-reeked cockroaches they are. The Norwegian King Magnus III of Norway, who sent unholy magical illnesses to English troops and butcherous barbarians to the front, pushed back the Scottish allies, leaving the rebels the chance to retake Scotland and slaughter Duncan as they tried to escape. William was horrified and annoyed by these events, but not surprised. The Scots were forever a pain on the Isles, and if they were to be taken, it would not be by him. He sent out one final army to take to the battle to the Scots, this time with Duncan's half-brother named Edgar. God, the Scots are a mess. So to recap, this guy the English killed to get this guy in charge, then this guy took over, so now the English want this guy to replace this guy. We good? Alright. Marching the army north, pushing them out one final time as Magnus used the last of his Nordic magic, finally giving a peace deal on the Isles as they fled. Edgar was crowned King of the Scots and left the deal with a mess, as William could maybe now be a peaceful king like he wanted before Robert's rebellion. Speaking of Robert, news came back from the Holy Land of his trek, which involved many great battles and triumphs over evil. When Robert returned to William, he was unrecognizable, clearly possessed by the Holy Spirit and forgiven in the eyes of his brother at long last.
Aye, 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 aye.
Hey. Oh, fuck yeah! Shit!
Once again suffering was William's destiny, however, as the French beat down the door to Normandy, forcing William to march forth, taking large swaths of northern Maine, but refusing to capture more for the time being. As great as he was, a king can only handle so much of the French.
Peace was drafted again,
and William traveled home, alongside the way, hunting with his now loyal brother and several noblemen. It was the first in a long time that William could truly be happy as he laughed and shot game with his brother Robert, telling tales of Scottish conquest and of the Holy Land. To the onlookers and to his brother's shock, a smile trickled down the king's face for perhaps the first time in his life. Robert cried in tears as one of the nobles they hunted with was secretly an assassin. Although no matter how many suspects Robert had slain, tortured, or interrogated that day, he would never know who was his brother's killer to even the time when Robert himself was on his deathbed. The nobles cheered for a chance to once again place a corrupt king on the throne, but as the corrupt nobility celebrated their evil acts against William, the priesthood had already found a new king to replace him. His youngest brother, Henry, and much like Robert, the clergy of England channeled the Holy Spirit into him, whipping him from an early age to value virtue over sin. As Henry was pronounced king, however, the upper class once again raised a hissy fit, shouting that Robert was to be king.
What the actual fuck did you just say to me right now?
Robert spoke with them all, telling him that he didn't want to be king any longer, being shown now the true path of righteousness. So, while Robert was with several women and jesters, enjoying his post-crusader life, the nobility went behind his back and declared a rebellion against Henry in Robert's name. The rebellion was then quickly crushed, as nobody wanted another civil war at this point, with Robert completely understanding, and, knowing of his duties to the crown, was sent away to retire. Now, with the nobles finally shut up for a moment, Henry was pronounced, this time also crowned, king, where he could now focus on securing the stability of the nation, because at this point, everyone was just sick of civil wars and corruption. So Henry took it upon himself to start making some adjustments to the system. First on that list was having the taxes gifted by the peasants and ripped from the nobles over to a royal exchequer to keep in safe place in case of emergencies, but it was made very clear this was not, and I repeat not, ransom money or bribe funds. Next, after having a sleep, Henry had a great epiphany to recruit from the lower classes, and, while many, including his loyal church followers, warned him against hiring from the peasants, Henry knew it would help deal with the wealthy mama's boys from buying into their place. Well, it would help stop them from buying into their places easily. Finally, Henry decided to look abroad. Seeing that the French and Welsh were up to something, he had to resist his good Anglo urges, and instead decide to marry a Scot. I know, I'm horrified too. It was necessary, however, to gain the Scottish as an ally, even if that meant marrying a savage. Although in all consideration, his Scot wife Matilda was as civilized as a haggis hoarder could be, living most of her life in a convent amongst nuns, helping Henry run the government while he traveled to both punish his enemies and meet his new armies. It was with her that Henry was 100% loyal, and had 9 sons and 13 daughters with her, and nobody else at all. The perfect couple if you subtract the kilts. All this buildup was necessary as well, as King Louis the Fat of France began to push hard into the topic of Normandy. Not literally, of course, but sending his messengers by the droves to torment England on the issue. You see, the status on which kingdom it was part of was messy to say the least, and up to that point was left as a semi-independent zone. But when Louis started whining about how the King of England needed to bow down to France and give their baguettes placed on gold plates funded by the English and other offers of tribute, Henry told the French exactly where they could place their moldy bread. France immediately began to chimp out, sending their forces to push England out, only to be held at the border. Several nobles tried to show their true colors and sided with the frogs, only to be replaced by true Englishmen, and with no chance on breaking the superior English soldiers, Louis was forced to bring his men home. Henry made it clear that Normandy was English, at least for now. With peace made on the French front, the devils of Paris had to find other ways to destroy England, and so they looked towards the backwards kingdoms of Wales. there they sent thousands of piles of gold, swords, and supplies, tricking them into striking the peaceful English and forcing Henry to save the souls of the Welsh from French control, even if it meant he must rule them instead. Sending his soldiers down south with Scottish reinforcements, he conquered the southern area of Wales, thereby sweeping out any French spies within the nation. This did, however, not teach Louis a lesson, because of course it didn't. So Henry prepared by arresting and dealing with several corrupt counts in Normandy, suspected of pocketing greasy, garlic-scented French gold. Henry proved this to be a wise move when Louis tried for, at this point, the third or second time? These Frenchmen. You think they would learn by now, but no. Instead, Henry needs to teach them again what it means to fight the English. So, after having a quick side quest and marrying his daughter Matilda to a soon-to-be Holy Roman Emperor for some prestige points, marched down south once again to attack the French. This time it was over Louis, without the Pope's permission, stealing his cousin Theobald's wife and making him marry one of his French goons. With his wife's honor on the line, Theobald bolted, with Henry siding over. Duo pushed ever deeper into France, cutting through the fog as they went, all while at home a conspiracy was born. Several noblemen attempted to kill Matilda, hoping to force Henry to give up the war and head home. The plot worked as Matilda died, but Henry refused to go home. He just kept fighting in France. Like, who does that? After ignoring the funeral to do just enough to the French to make them once again scramble back home and stop stealing wives, Henry finally came home to England, only to hear grave news. His son and heir to the throne died in a freak accident with his ship sinking. Henry broke, refusing to speak to anyone for days, only speaking to his second wife, to whom he paid no attention to, only having her at all for the chance to have another legitimate successor. But alas, he was unable to be given such a child. The only option seemed to be the weak-minded Stephen, horrible Frenchman whose only reason for his marriage was to trick a young, impressionable woman into sharing her riches with him, and to bribe several men within the court to support his claim to power. He became even as bold as to go directly to Henry and ask to be given his royal castles along with a pledge of allegiance, which of course Henry denied, as no matter what happens in history, the English have one rule to always follow. Never, ever trust a Frenchie. But Henry got more ill by the day, desperately needed someone to fill his shoes. Luckily enough, hope would come from Germany of all places. The unexpected miracle of our tale? Matilda. That girl from page 7 of the script that Henry married off? Apparently her husband died, making her come back home with fresh leadership capabilities, and more importantly, she wasn't French! With that in mind, Henry immediately began drafting a plan for Matilda to be his heir. This was important because, while the next rebellion came and went, because of course it did, Henry dropped dead in the countryside due to illness, with everybody ready to claim the throne. This civil war would be different from the others, however, spreading chaos throughout the countryside. A time of crisis. It would be the anarchy. Stephen's regime took place immediately upon Henry's death, seizing the crown for himself and beginning to bribe his loyal stooges within the palace, promising all the gifts and power they could want. While he did all this, however, he was secretly contacted by his dark master, who of course was that
fuck you.
His dark master helped secure his apprentice's throne by joining forces with a corrupt priest who stole the title of Pope, all so that the new ironically named Pope Innocent could claim Stephen as the true King of England, and in turn cast a dark shadow across the nation, while the true claimants had to hide away and prepare for total war against their invaders.
Stay strong! Stay with me! We ain't done yet!
Matilda began her attack, landing 140 loyal knights on the shores of England, holding castles along the Welsh borders, sending off her loyal ally, Earl Robert, to convince those still saintly within the nobility to help the Brits' cause against the evil French Trinity. They found that loyalty in another like-minded hero, Earl Miles Fitzwalter, who as soon as he could renounced the French puppet and joined the glorious revolution, to much of the joy of Matilda and the fear of Stephen. In retaliation, the horde broke through the lines, surrounding the castle, holding Matilda and arresting her. And in the ultimate girl boss moment, her Anglo DNA was crossed with her dead husband's DNA of a Holy Roman Emperor, morphing her into a full-blown psychic, breaking his mind and forcing Stephen to release Matilda and her entire guards unit back into her lands and reunite with Robert without any problems. Immediately on her return, she was attacked again by Stephen and by Wallingford Castle, only to be repelled by the local garrison.
Run away! Run away! Run away!
Then deciding to change course and capture two other strongholds nearby, reaching untold horrors upon the landscape as he did it. In a flawless maneuver to respond, Matilda ordered a counterattack which would crush the army of Stephen, with combined forces of the Welsh, peasants, and loyalists moving in on London, leaving Stephen to do nothing but cry in his castle as he cries for his master in Paris to save him. When no hope from the continent was apparent, Stephen rode out in a deluded fantasy that he may somehow defeat the warrior queen and her court at the town of Lincoln. The battle was a massacre for Stephen, his men lopping off the heads of Matilda's Welsh forces faster than King Louis can lop buttons off of blouses. But the larger forces won the day as Matilda spread her forces around the army, and then marched towards the center, thus defeating Stephen. Preparing to check the budget, Queen Matilda noticed that the treasure was left bare as can be. Stephen spent it all in tribute to the French and on himself. This all made the situation dire as the secret French followers launched their plan to free Stephen to the throne. The guards immediately betrayed the queen, capturing Robert. Meanwhile, Matilda barely made it out alive, with Stephen forced to follow in chains. Stephen was later traded in order to save her loyal friend Robert. Battles would ensue for the coming years, with no side strong enough to deal a winning blow. King Louis, to whom Stephen gained much of his power, though, died, most likely crushed under his own weight, leaving his son Louis the Younger in charge. As for Matilda, her followers slowly shriveled away in old age, while the others chose to fight in the Second Crusade, leaving her with few supporters. This included Robert, who died, following Matilda as loyal as ever until the last breath. It was only with luck that she outlived Stephen, but her people did not want her anymore. They cried out for her son, Henry II, to be their king. So Matilda bid goodbye, and, for the rest of her life, would watch over Normandy for her, loyal as ever to her son, much like Robert had been for her. Before Henry arrived in the capital, however, he had something to deal with first. In Paris, King Louis the Younger was already plotting to place Stephen's son Eustace as the new Duke of Normandy, marching forward with his best men to challenge the new king's mettle, only to meet a united force so strong it'd scare the Frenchmen off. But not only that, but also made King Louis's wife, Eleanor, one of the most wealthy and beautiful women in Europe, fall immediately in love, seeing what a true man should be capable of. Louis knew his simple mind would be incapable of competing with such a mastermind such as Henry, and divorced her, who swung first thing into the arms of Henry. Just like his grandfather, he took this marriage for both love, but also for strategical mind games on his enemies. Eleanor owned heaps of French lands that Louis had to beg Eleanor to borrow for his own kingdom, but now married to Henry, those lands were now given as the ultimate engagement gift. That map doesn't deceive you, ladies and gentlemen. The King of England owns more of France than King Louis of France. When the French court realized this, they immediately went mad, launching another assault down south to attack the new lands with yet another obscure, jealous family member. But just like the others, Henry prepared for an attack and beat them back like so many before.
How many times do we have to teach you this lesson, old man?
I love the young people.
This time, Henry took to the woods, striking only when hidden in the shadows, successfully defending his kingdom's new lands. Eventually, after another tiring campaign ended in English victory, Louis retreated like his father before him due to great illness, which naturally was due to the stomach pains from his diet of wine and frogs. After finally returning home after years away from his own kingdom, thank you, Louis, Henry was crowned King of the English.
And there was much rejoicing.
In teeny parts of France, but that's more just an add-on to the main thing. Every single nobleman sided with Henry, much to the annoyance of Stephen's children, who swore that for the rest of their lives they would avenge their father. So naturally, they died within 3 years. Yeah, nobody ever really said the French genes were good, so I'm surprised they lived as long as they did. The first issue of the newly crowned king's mind was the treasury, most notably the fact there wasn't a treasury anymore. He gave thanks to Stephen's reign and his civil war for that. Henry knew he could only do this if he listened to the wise counsel of those around him, and with the help of both the clergymen and noblemen alike, These plans included cutting expenses on useless dusty castles to replace with new churches and establishing courts and law systems throughout the country. Not all agree with Henry's changes in the nation. The largest leader of those anti-English happiness faction was a man named Thomas Becket, also known as the Archbishop of Canterbury. Becket would make Henry's life a living hell as much as he could, demanding changes to taxes, demanding special rights for him and his supporters, and other such travesties. This all got worse after signing a few laws which basically told Becket to chill out and remind him that he isn't the Pope, led to both of them going to the actual Pope to solve this problem. Pope Alexander III, who was the Pope at the time, was well respected for his involvement in several religious matters before this. It was he who sent the Teutonic Knights to the small, unimportant lands of Prussia. It was also he who denied the Byzantine heretics any compromise after defiling the Church's holy texts with their orthro-whatever that they practice in the East. And now it is he that Henry and Becket went to and mediated a truce between them, which mostly watered down to a 90s sitcom ending.
Boys, you can't keep fighting like this.
But Pope Alexander III.
No buts, I already have to deal with that Frederick kid trying to take the power of the church. Now make up and go home.
Fine.
Returning home, Henry thought about how every English king needs to deal with the same civil wars, corruption, and chaos of the world alone. So he came up with a genius plan. He, Henry, grandson to the great Henry, would share his crown with his son, Henry. Wow, this family line really likes the name Henry. So, with a little squabbling between adult Henry II and Bishop Becket, young Henry was crowned co-monarch of England, ensuring no problems at all will be coming of this. Yup. There was a small instance after the ceremony where Becket was excommunicating innocent supporters of the king, only to be confronted by several knights, demanding he come with them to face trial for his evil deeds. In response, Becket smugly stated that he would not be arrested, resulting in the knights calmly taking a breath, walking up to him, and hacking off his limbs and killing him. Henry heard wind of this from Ireland and told the Pope he was very sorry about this, having no clue what actually happened, and sadly was unable to assist in the investigation. So, because of the savage slaughter of a priest, Becket was proclaimed a saint, forever endearing himself to the popular— Wait a fucking minute. What the heck is Henry doing in Ireland? Turns out, what Henry was doing in Ireland was helping out some local Irish lords in some land squabbles. Now, Henry had no connection to these land squabbles. That was, until one of the lords offered to serve Henry, in return for his protection and teachings, hearing of his great reforms and wanting the same to be done to his backwater island. Henry at first didn't want to do it, seeing the Irish as a people too far lost. But Pope Alexander once again came over to tell Henry it was his duty as a Catholic king to help out his fellow man. And because of that, Henry was fighting and then taking land in Ireland. Finally resting after his countless victories, England was stronger than ever. Sitting atop his throne, Henry pondered what to do next, and decided to check on his sons. Going to his children's bedroom, he saw a note. Upon reading it, he did not know how to feel other than betrayed. His own children, Henry and Godfrey, have decided to declare war on him for the throne. He ran towards his wife to tell her this news as well, only to learn that she joined the rebellion as well, and in fact was the one who influenced her children to revolt. To make matters worse, he then learned that Scottish forces have pierced the border, striking into his lands once again. All this swirled in his mind, wondering who could have done such horrors to civilization. What monster could have been so cruel as to do this? I think you know who it is, and of course it is. This was all the plan of King Louis the goddamn 7th of France. There, Henry, I know. You really don't get a break, do you? Alright, let's do this. After learning his wife was secretly a French sleeper agent sent to corrupt his children's minds, Henry readied for the greatest war of his reign. First, several barons revolted on the side of the rebels. Meanwhile, Henry called upon the finest mercenaries in all the world to battle by his side. The Pope was ridden to help by both sides, and this time he decided to just let them fight, as he was as sick of this shit as I am.
We've all agreed on a pause or a ceasefire in the border region of Syria. And it was unconventional what I did. I said, they're gonna have to fight a little while. Sometimes you have to let them fight a little while. Then people find out how tough the fighting is. These guys know right up here. These guys know. Right? Sometimes you have to let them fight. It's like two kids in a lot. You gotta let them fight and then you pull them apart.
And with that, The first battle begins between Louis and Henry's forces on the continent, their soldiers marching through the lands of Flanders to surprise the English forces, while another force marches from the west. This attack startled the English forces, only for them to charge anyways, wiping out the army of the French through sheer strength and power. The army of the west broke at the sight of the English army, and was captured by Henry personally, holding the continental advancement for the time being. Louis mustered up another force, this time larger and more heavily armored. They charged ahead forward into Normandy, only to get bogged down by the weather, and forced away until the season fared better. During this time, Henry begged his sons to come to their senses, only to hear them all refuse. The Scot king, William the Lion, charged from up north in an attempt to relieve pressure off Louis, only to forget that Scots have always been known as strong yet unintelligent savages, unable to be controlled in battle. This led to them breaking formation and being plucked off quickly by English archers, with William himself captured put in the Newcastle Zoo until he chose to pledge loyalty to England and pay a tribute of £26,000. He agreed and was released, ending the Scottish front just like that. Henry claimed that this was all divine punishment for his murder of Becket and prayed for forgiveness before returning to Normandy for one last fight. As both sides gathered in the fields of Normandy, Henry charged forward with all he had. The battle was like no other, every side of the west. For days the battle, bodies hitting the floor like sacks of bricks and fire. Dust settled, Henry stood victorious, and Louis began to finally beg for peace.
Here's the traitor, your majesty.
Please, your omnipotence, have mercy.
After you've scrubbed all the floors in Hyrule, then we can talk about mercy. Take him away.
Henry paused for a moment, overjoyed with his victory over his rebellious children, Scotland, and of course, once again, France. He was redeemed before God, and the Great Revolt, after so many battles and hardship, was over. After the war, his wife was imprisoned on the crime of being French, with his sons punished dearly for their disloyalty. Louis tried to break the treaty, but the papacy intervened once again, this time to tell Louis to not try anything, which he didn't. Henry's happiness was halted by all of his children all dying one by one after this, however. Joffrey to some French tournament. Henry, the once co-king, already died while looting a church during the revolt. This left only two children he thought were worthy of taking the throne. One night at a meeting, one of his children slammed the table, demanding his father make him the heir. All people went silent and looked at this boy. He fought his father in the revolt, but chose to pledge his loyalty ever since. And during the campaign was disgusted with the tactics of his brothers, preferring courage and arms over cowardice and spycraft. He was young, with a red beard and a warrior's physique, his voice booming above all the others in the room like that of an avenging angel from heaven. Immediately, Henry knew who to pick. It was to be his final son, Richard. Richard the Lionheart. But that is a story for another day. I'll see you then.
So that's all true. All of that is exactly what happened. Word for word.
Well, maybe I didn't say every single tiny little syllable, no, but basically I said them, yeah.
Basically.